My colleagues in government, friends and distinguished guests from India and abroad. I'm happy to be here today to address the 6th Delhi Economic Conclave. This is a good platform for bringing together economists, policymakers, leaders from India and abroad. I compliment the Ministry of Finance. Your topic of discussion is GEM, that is Jan Dhan Yojana, Aadhaar and mobile. This GEM vision will serve at the bedrock of many initiatives to come. For me, GEM is about just achieving maximum value for every rupee spent, maximum empowerment, maximum technology penetration among the masses. But let me start by taking a brief look at the Indian economy. By almost every major economic indicators, India is doing better than when we took office 17 months ago. GDP growth is up and inflation is down. Foreign investment is up and current account deficit is down. Revenues are up, are down. The fiscal deficit is down and the rupee is stable. Obviously, this did not happen by accident. And the world economy is not exactly doing well. This success is the result of a series of well-thought policies. Many of the purely macroeconomic reforms we have undertaken are probably well known to this audience. We have embarked on a course of fiscal consolidation. We have entered for the first time into a monetary framework agreement with the Reserve Bank to curb inflation. When while cutting the fiscal deficit, we have substantially increased productive public investment. This has been made possible in two ways. Firstly, we have imposed carbon taxes on fossil fuels. We took the bold step of decontrolling diesel prices and thereby eliminated energy subsidies. We have replaced them with taxes. The coal cess had been increased by 4 times from rupees 50 per ton to rupees 200 per ton. Globally, there is much talk of carbon taxes, but less to say. And it's the talk and talk is going on. We have actually acted. Secondly, we have reduced wasteful expenditure through innovative methods like the use of technology. Some of the methods are part of your agenda, such as using Aadhaar to target subsidies to the deserving. There are reforms that you are probably aware of. But our reforms are far broader and far deeper than is generally recognized. Before elaborate on this, I would like to raise two issues. The first is reform for what? What is the aim of reform? Is it just to increase the measured rate of GDP growth? Or is it to bring about a transformation in society? My answer is clear. We must reform to transform. The second question is, reform for whom? Who is the target audience? Is our aim to impress groups of experts and score points in intellectual discussions, or to achieve ranks in some international league table? Again, my answer is clear. Reform is that which helps all citizens, and especially the poor, achieve a better life. It is Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas. In short, reform is not an end. Reform for me is just a way station on the long journey to the destination. The destination is transformation of India. Therefore, reform to transform and reforming to transform is a marathon, not a sprint. The reforms we have undertaken are of many types. For simplicity, I will classify them as financial, structural, and institutional. It will not be possible to cover all of them here, but I will certainly mention some of the most important. Let me start with the financial reforms. Interest rates and credit policy. Changes in interest rates are debated for months. Tons of newsprints and hours of television are spent on it. Interest rates are no doubt very, very important. But are they important to a person locked out of the banking system? To a person who had no prospect of ever lending or borrowing from the bank? And if a large section of a country are in this position, then how important are interest rates? It is for this reason that development experts have been advocating financial inclusion. What we have done in the last 17 months is to bring 190 million people into the banking system. This is more than the population of most of the countries in the world. Now, these millions are part of our banking system, and words like interest rate have a meaning for these poor people. Not only have these people been brought into the system, but they have shown that there is a great strength at the bottom of the pyramid. Believe it or not, accounts opened under the Jan Dhan Yojana today have a total balance of almost rupees 26,000 crores, or nearly $4 billion. Clearly, our financial inclusion reform has been transformational, and yet this quiet revolution has hardly been noticed. The Jan Dhan Yojana has also transformed the ability of the poor to make and to receive electronic payments. Every Jan Dhan account holder is eligible for a debit card. India's banks are also being encouraged to operate mobile ATMs. A mobile ATM is one where cash can be drawn and simple banking tasks done through a handheld device. Thanks to Jan Dhan Yojana and the RuPay debit card, we also introduced healthy competition in the debit credit card space. This has traditionally been dominated by a few international players. Even 1 year ago, there were hardly any indigenous card brands in the market. Today, 36% of debit cards in India are RuPay cards. Financial inclusion is not just about opening bank accounts or enabling electronic payments. I firmly believe that India has tremendous entrepreneurial energy. This needs to be harnessed so that we become a nation of job creators rather than job seekers. When took office, we found that 58 million non-corporate enterprises provided 128 million jobs. 60% of them were in rural areas. Over 40% were owned by people from the backward classes and 15% by scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. But bank credit accounted for a teeny share for their financing. Most of them never get any bank credit. In other words, the most employment incentive sector of the economy gets the least credit, while Jan Dhan Yojana was to bring banking to the unbanked. The second reform was to bring funding to unfunded. We are creating a new financing and regulatory architecture under Development and Refinance Agency scheme, popularly known as MUDRA. Already under the Pradhan Mantri MUDRA Yojana, banks have provided more than 6 million loans to small businesses for a total value of nearly rupees 38,000 crores or a $6 billion. If one conservatively estimates that each loan creates 2 jobs, we have laid the foundation for 12 million new jobs. Even rupees 200,000 crores invested in the corporate sector would not produce. Now launch a program where each branch of each bank, that is total of 1,25,000 bank branches, will assist one Dalit or a scheduled tribe person and one woman in starting a business. We are also creating an environment that fosters innovation and startups through the Atal Innovation Mission and the Self-Employment and Talent Utilization Program. Another financial reform is the provision of a safety net through new social security schemes. We have introduced 3 non-subsidy but low-cost schemes covering accident insurance, life insurance, and pensions. Because of their massive coverage, the premiums are low. There are now over 120 million subscribers. For many of these reforms to be successful, we need a strong banking system. We inherited a system where cronyism and corruption were believed to be a rampant in banking decisions and in appointments to public sector banks. After the first ever retreat of a prime minister with bankers, known as the Gnan Sangam, we have moved decisively to change this. Major steps have been taken to improve efficiency, including clear performance measures and accountability mechanisms. We have made a commitment to ensuring adequate capital. But more than that, there have been very powerful non-official steps. Interference in banking decisions has ended. A new process for appointments is being put on place under the Bank Boards Bureau. Credible and capable bankers have been appointed to head banks. For the first time since banks were nationalized 46 years ago, private sector professionals have been appointed in key positions. This is a major reform. There is a whole ecosystem focused on alleviating poverty. Perhaps this can be called the poverty alleviation industry. Obviously, the intentions are good. Well-designed schemes and subsidies do have an important place. But empowering the poor is far more effective than empowering the poverty alleviation industry. Our financial reforms empower the poor to fight poverty themselves. I can take analogy of a house. The foundation and basic structure occupies some of the cost. Then come the fixtures, fittings and furniture. If the foundation and structure are weak, any investment in nice fittings or attractive floor tiles or beautiful curtains is unlikely to last long. So also, empowering the poor through financial inclusion and social security will provide a more stable and lasting solution. Let me now turn to structural reform in various sectors. Agriculture remains India's mainstay in terms of providing livelihood. We have introduced a series of reforms. There was a tendency to divert subsidized fertilizer for the production of chemicals. A simple but very effective solution is neem coating of fertilizer, which makes it unsuitable for diversion. This had been tried on a small scale earlier. We are now moving towards universal neem coating of urea. The small additional cost is recovered through a marginal price increase, and hence the whole scheme involves the incremental subsidy. This has already saved crores of rupees of diverted farm subsidies. It is an example of how simple reforms can be very effective. We have introduced a soil health card nationally, which tells every farmer the condition of his or her soil. It enables the farmers to choose the right quantity and mix of inputs. This greatly reduces wastage of inputs and increase crop yields besides protecting the soil. By reducing unnecessary chemical inputs, good for health of consumers. It enables farmers to choose the best crop for their soil. Many farmers have been unaware that their land is actually more suitable for a different crop. In economic terms, it is a win-win-win. It reduces costs, increases yields, improves the environment, and protect the health of consumers. 140 million soil health cards will be issued, requiring a collection of over 25 million soil samples. They will be tested through a nationwide network of nearly 1,500 laboratories. About 4 million samples have already been collected. This too is a reform to transform. We have launched a Housing for All program, one of the most ambitious in the world. It involves building 20 million urban houses and 30 million rural houses, totaling nearly 50 million. The program will make sure no Indian is houseless. It will also generate a large amount of employment, mainly for the unskilled, the semi-skilled, and the poor. This multi-pronged program is also a transformative reform. Much has been said and written about India's labor markets. We have already undertaken some important steps. Many workers in the organized sector have suffered when changing jobs by being unable to access provident fund and other benefits. The benefits accrued under one employer become difficult to account for under another employer. We have introduced a universal account number, which will remain with an employee even when he changes jobs. This greatly improves labor mobility and makes life easier for employers and employees. We have gone a step further. We have started empowering the unorganized sector employees by giving them a universal identity number and providing certain minimum social security benefits to them. Over a period of years, this will have a major impact on the quality of employment in India. Before becoming Prime Minister, I had received many inputs about the reforms needed in India from many economic experts. However, none of them touched on the issue of cleanliness and sanitation. Sanitation had languished for years as a poor cousin of health or a drinking water supply. It has often been viewed as a question of budgets and projects and expenditure. Yet, you will all agree that poor sanitation and lack of cleanliness is much more than an issue of health. It touches upon every aspect of our well-being. It is of particular importance to women. For Swachh Bharat or Clean India campaign will impact not only health and sanitation, but also uplift the status and security of women and above all, create a powerful sense of well-being. If this reform succeeds, and I'm confident it will, India would have been transformed. We have undertaken major managerial improvements in transport sector. Our major ports have seen a 5% growth in traffic and an 11% increase in operating income in 2014-15, despite a global contraction in trade volume. The Shipping Corporation of India had been making losses continuously for several years and had loss of 275 crore rupees in 2013-14. In 2014-15, it earned a profit of rupees 201 crore, a turnaround of nearly rupees 500 crores in 1 year. The pace of award of new highway works has increased from 5.2 kilometers per day in 2012-13 and 8.7 kilometer per day in 2013 and 14 to 23.4 kilometer per day currently. This managerial reform in the working of the public sector will have large multiplier effects throughout the economy. Another measure we have taken is to identify what can be called dead money and use it productively. The best example is gold. India is well known for its cultural affinity for gold. As economists, you will probably understand that this so-called cultural affinity has a strong witness high inflation. Gold is an excellent hedge and a highly portable store of value. It is portability and usability also make it a source of empowerment of women who traditionally are the main owners of gold jewelry. However, this microeconomic virtue can become a macroeconomic vice. It implies a high level of gold imports. We have just launched a series of gold-related schemes. This will provide Indians with the inflation protection of gold among with a modest interest without actually holding it. If the scheme reaches its potential, it will help meet the rational expectations of the public while moderating imports. Surely, this too is an important reform with potential to transform. Let me now turn to institutional and governance reforms. For years, the Planning Commission was widely criticized. It was generally seen as a cumbersome centralizing force which imposed central will on the states. It is another matter that some of its strongest critics suddenly developed a nostalgic admiration for the institution they had hated till the previous day. After coming to power, we created a new institution, the National Institution for Transforming India, or NITI. My vision of NITI is very different from the Planning Commission. It is to be a collaborative forum for ideas and action where states are full partners and where center and states meet in a spirit of cooperative federalism. Perhaps some people thought this was merely a slogan, but we already have concrete example of its transformative power. Let me explain. As you all know, the 14th Finance Commission recommended that states be given an enhanced share of central revenues as automatic devolution. Despite some internal advice to the contrary, I decided to accept the recommendation. This has created a need to restructure centrally sponsored schemes. Ever since the first five-year plan in 1952, such decisions were taken unilaterally by the center. We did something very different. The task force fixing the sharing pattern of central schemes was entrusted not to a group of central ministers, but to a subgroup of chief ministers in NITI. And I am delighted to say that in a fine example of cooperative federalism at its best, the chief ministers have unanimously agreed on a set of recommendations. This is despite the fact that this is a very complex issue and that दे कम फ्रॉम मेनी डिफरेंट पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज. आई रिसीव द रिपोर्ट ऑन 27 अक्टूबर. द मेन रिकमेंडेशन ऑन द शेयरिंग पैटर्न वॉज एक्सेप्टेड द वेरी सेम डे एंड रिटर्न इंस्ट्रक्शन वर इश्यूड द वेरी नेक्स्ट डे. ऑन मेनी अदर इश्यूज टू द चीफ मिनिस्टर्स आर टेकिंग द लीड इन सेटिंग द नेशनल एजेंडा. By reforming the institution, we have transformed the relationship. Our work on Make in India and ease of doing business is, of course, well known. Our push to Make in India must be viewed in the context of the very slow growth in world trade. The growth rate of trade exceeded GDP growth from 1983 to 2008. Since then, trade has been growing more slowly than GDP. Therefore, producing for domestic consumption is important for growth. You are all probably aware that India has substantially improved its ranking in the World Bank's Doing Business survey. But a new feature is a very healthy and constructive competition among states. You will be surprised to know that among the top few states are Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, and Odisha. This is an example of constructive competitive federalism. In a break with over 65 years of tradition, we have involved states even in foreign policy. The Ministry of External Affairs has been asked to work with the states. When I visited China, a state-to-state summit was also held, and states have been asked to create export promotion councils. Making the states think globally is yet another reform with potential to transform. I firmly believe that India's people are far more mature and far more public spirited than armchair critics and experts give them credit for. An important governance issue is the mutual trust between citizens and the state. We made a beginning in trusting the citizens by abolishing many requirements for attestation of signatures. For example, the Department of Higher Education has permitted self-attestation by students of documents used admission in various academic courses. We also ended the requirement of to visit government offices for life certification for pensioners by introducing online biometric identification. Warna har baar pension lene wale ko jinda hone ka saboot dena padta tha. Economists have traditionally believed that people act in their self-interest, but India has a long tradition of voluntarism. We introduced the Give It Up campaign, seeking the cooperation of the public in voluntarily giving up cooking gas subsidies. We promised that for every connection given up, one poor family currently without gas would be given a connection. This will enable us to liberate many poor women from the health hazards of using firewood, including the response has been tremendous. Within a few months, over 4 million Indians have given up their cooking gas subsidies. Most of them are not rich households and belong to the lower middle class. And I would like to say, if any one of you in this room still have a subsidized connection, let me appeal to you to join them. This brings me to an achievement that I think even our worst critics do not dispute. This is the change in the levels of corruption. For many years, economists एंड अदर एक्सपर्ट्स हैव हेल्ड करप्शन टू बी वन ऑफ द मेन कंस्ट्रेंट्स ऑन द ग्रोथ ऑफ एनी डेवलपिंग इकोनॉमी. वी हैव टेकन डिसिजिव स्टेप्स टू कर्ब करप्शन. आई हैव ऑलरेडी रिफर्ड टू व्हाट हैज बीन डन इन पब्लिक सेक्टर बैंक्स. अनदर मेजर रिफॉर्म इज वेल नोन. दिस इज द रिमूवल ऑफ डिस्क्रिशन इन एलोकेशन ऑफ की रिसोर्सिस. आवर ऑक्शंस ऑफ कोल स्पेक्ट्रम एंड एफएम रेडियो लाइसेंसेज हैव प्रोड्यूस मेजर एडिशनल रेवेन्यूज. इन द केस ऑफ कोल द मेजर बेनिफिशरीज आर सम ऑफ इंडियाज पुअरेस्ट स्टेट्स हु विल नाउ हैव मच मोर रिसोर्सिस फॉर डेवलपमेंट. Interviews for lower level government jobs have widely been seen as a source of corruption. We have recently abolished the system of interviews for lower level posts in government. We will rely on transparent written examination results to decide who will be selected. Our campaign against tax evasion and money laundering is also well known. 6,500 crores rupees has been assessed before the new Black Money Act was implemented. Additionally, over rupees 4,000 crores has been declared under the new Act. Thus, over rupees 10,500 crores of black money from abroad has been detected and assessed. If we can sustain this improvement in integrity and transparency, what can be a more transformative reform? We are also taking several steps to serve the honest taxpayer better. In our electronic filing of returns now covers 85% of all tax returns. Earlier, electronic returns had to be followed by a paper verification which used to take weeks to be processed. This year, we have introduced e-verification using Aadhaar and over 4 million taxpayers made use of this facility. For them, the entire process was simple, inept electronic and completed instantly with no paper at all. This year, 91% of electronic returns were processed within 90 days as compared to 46% last year. Nearly 90% of refunds were issued within 90 days. I have asked the Income Tax Department to move to a system where not only returns but also scrutiny is done without having to go to the office. Queries could be raised and answered online or by email. There should be a visible electronic trail of what is pending, with whom, where, and for how long. This is being piloted in 5 big cities. I have also instructed that the performance appraisal system for income tax officials be changed. The appraisal should reflect whether or not the officer's order and assessment have been upheld on appeal. This will deter corruption and also motivate officers to pass correct orders. When full changes, namely online changes in performance appraisal, have transformative potential. This is a distinguished gathering. We have many interesting and thought-provoking sessions. My appeal to all of you is to think beyond conventional remedies. We should not limit our ideas to few standard notions. Our idea of reforms should be inclusive and broad-based. The goal of reform is not better headlines in the big papers, but better lives for our people. I'm sure you, with your knowledge, will come up your ideas. I look forward to hearing from you of more reforms to transform, which will make life better for the whole of India. Then, not only we in India, but the whole world will be benefited. Thank you. Thanks a lot.